100 dahlias, so whatever I say might not be good for you, so I mean, but you can, but I think you can still get something out of the meeting, no matter one or two things. So, and then sawdust, vermiculite, peat moss, everybody does something different. My best advice I could give everybody is do whatever works for you and either keep doing it, or if you want to try something new, then do 1/4 of your tubers or a half of your tubers. Don't do it all. So that's my best advice that I can give.
Nope, not yet. You have to tell me that.
Okay. My backyard. Nice to start the meeting today with that. Can't wait to see the dahlias growing this year. So, well, my object today is for you to walk away with some kind of a tip. I'll start off first with my most important things in my yard, my house. Every year I get a new Bible. I haven't even took it out of the package yet. I have a Bible, and I'm really going to start putting the dates when I start bringing up my tubers, warming them up, when I plant my first one, when I dig up my first one. You know, you think you're going to remember all of this, and you do forget. So I'd say get yourself a little book and call it your Dahlia Bible. I know where my dahlias are in the book at any time during the year, because I just keep track of it. How do I keep track of it? I have a tape recorder. So I'll plant a garden, and then I'll go back with my tape recorder, and I'll just say, okay, I planted 3 Wednesday, 4 Farmer John's, and then I just write it in my Bible book. So, okay, out of the year, I don't thank dahlias for like a couple months. Because they're sleeping in my basement between 40 to 50 degrees, and this year it's been pretty good. They've been at 50 degrees the whole time. They have not fluctuated the time, so I don't have to think about dahlias when they're sleeping. So, some of the tools I use are. I used to be really cheap. I wouldn't spend $18 on the scissors. They're like a bonsai shear. And then one year I got them. I'll give up my firstborn child before I give up these, because they really, you can get in where you see an eye, and they cut really, really good. And then when they get dull, you can get a sharpener and sharpen them. And Vinny knows how to sharpen them. I got one too. You know, we can sharpen your tools when you bring them in. And what I use to tie up my tubers, and they don't leave the house without a name because I'm not going to remember the name. So every single tuber that goes out of my house has a tag. And I use red because a good friend of mine said if you put red around your tuber, you can see it. One year I put yellow, and you didn't know if it was brown, if it was part of the root or what. So red is good. And then the stakes. Use the stakes. And then we have markers on sale if anybody wants to buy a marker today. And you want to use these kind. They're the industrial strength. They're up to 500 degrees because and then the sun doesn't bleach them out as quickly. Or you get a good marker, and it won't bleach it out. So you want to get these kind. So in mid-March, I bring up my dahlias up, and I leave them out in my family room for a couple weeks, and then I start looking through them, start cutting them up and tagging them.
Be honest. They're not just in your family. No.
They're everywhere.
I have pictures to prove they're in my family room.
Yeah, but they're everywhere.
That's what's nice when my dahlias are sleeping. I don't have to worry about it. The rest of the time, they're all over the place. Okay? But, all right. Okay. I'm going to pass some of these out. I came up with dual. The red yarn goes this way, and the green yarn goes this way. The green yarn is for tying my dahlias, and these are for tagging them. And if you do that quite a few times and then cut it, you can get the length that you want. If you want them a little longer, get poster board is what this is. For a dollar, you can get tons of these. And make them to the size. If you want the green one, if you want a real, real long piece, then you just cut it once. If you want a shorter piece, when you first start cutting your tubers, you cut both ends, and then you have the right string.
How long is that?
How long is
18
that?
18
inches. About 18 inches?
I don't know. Here, you can take this one.
Yeah.
And I get my yarn. I get it at Joann Fabrics. This is the 1 pound, and this is $9.99, and it's acrylic, I guess. 100% acrylic.
It is acrylic. That's what I
yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, I don't know. I mean, after a few years, mine disintegrates too. What if you change it every year? But it's $10, but I give the 60%, so it's $4 for the whole thing. And I don't even go through a whole one of these in a year. And the same thing with the green. But I get two or three of these guys. And I'll just take them all and put them all at once. And I can get a lot of them done. And I didn't bring my apron this year, but you take all your green yarn and you cut it and everything. And then you put a safety pin around it. And you can tie it on you, so when you go outside, you have your two hands free, and you have the yarn ready to tie up your tubers, because we do need extra hands when we're tying up the tubers. And I needed real long ones this year. It just seemed, though, even though it was a bad year for tubers, I needed. So I would safety pin this on me, and then just pull it off and tie one, and then tie another one. So, okay. Okay. My blizzard, and there'll be some other pictures of the blizzard tuber as I pop them up. First of April, soil, pots, trays, and shelves. That's what I do. I use, the pots are on sale today. I highly recommend if you have more than, I don't know, 20, 40 dahlias that you want to plant a year, to get yourself a metal shelf. And I like the one with the wheels because I actually wheel them in and out of my garage, mostly my front yard. I can wheel them out and then wheel them back in if it's going to rain or something. So investing in a metal shelf with wheels. And then in the wintertime, does anybody want to know what I do with it?
Yes.
I put all my junk on it and I can wheel it around my basement. Because it's, instead of moving boxes all the time, you put it on the shelf and you just wheel it around where you need to take it. So the shelf with wheels works really good, and I tray up my tubers. This is blizzard, so it doesn't have stakes. It doesn't have stakes in every single dahlia, but when I tuber up different ones, they'll each have a stake. They'll have one tied to the tuber, but they'll also have one next to it. So when I'm planting them, I already have the stake too. So, time-consuming.
Individual sections or tubers. You're putting them in trays.
I'm putting them in trays.
Straight up and down.
Yeah. here's my trace. What I do is in between, I can fit between 40 and 60 dahlias in one of these. If you're going to plant 40 dahlias, you want to just have one tray. You'll have them all there. Bunch, and then I put a section, I do another bunch, and I put a section, and then I just put dirt all over it. I do start with dirt, and then I, you know, anybody wants to see me do this, just come to my house, take a card, call me up, we'll make plans.
What's your work?
Yes. Anybody want to know how to cut them? I have the scissors. I bought 10 of these because I can't be without them, but I'm willing to sell them for what I paid for, $13 if anybody wants to buy it here. But I'm saying you really need these. So call me. Questions, you want to come over, you want me to show you how to cut them. I'm not saying I've got the most knowledge. I'm just the craziest one that grows the most dahlias. But, you know, if you need help with anything, I'm willing to tell you what I do and show you, and you can come and spend time with me. Yep.
Is there enough soil around?
Yep. You want to make sure they got water, because they have enough soil. And I put netting in it. So as I pull them out, I pull the netting, and as I pull the netting, the next layer that have been partitioned come out. And it actually comes out like that, and then I break them apart, and I'm not losing a lot of roots by doing that, just a few that are in the netting. But that helps me pull them out, is why I put netting on the bottom of my. And this year I washed it, and I got it all again. But yeah, it just works really, really good for me. And I don't have 1,500 pots. I have maybe 30 trays with 40 dahlias in it. So for me, it works really good. But it saves a lot of time. And it's not that hard to carry them out, too, if you're traying up your dahlias. So if you need trays, let me know. Okay, here's my shelf on wheels that I recommend everybody get. And then a few dahlias we got to throw them in there. AC Dark Horse. I love the petals on that one. Okay, once you put them in a tray or in a pot, you do want to water them. You don't want to overwater them, but you're going to rot out the tuber. But you want to start putting some moisture in the soil so that they will start to root up. And I'd say first week in April 15th, something around like that, when you want to start potting up your tubers so that they're strong enough to go in the ground in May. Okay. Okay. This is what it used to look like when I had all my pots. It probably still looks like that, but they're in trays. But yeah, that was my front window, and you know, I've got an imagination. I put a table on top to get more room. So it's another table. It's like, where am I, you know, because I run out of room too.
My wife will love that.
And then I was doing this, but now I have my shelves that I can't be without. But I would take a table, and I put wheels underneath so you could wheel it in and out of your garage. So that's good, but a couple of times the wheels sort of fell off, so I suggest tying them onto the legs of the table if you're going to do something like that. But I mean, then it's movable. You can take it from outside to inside. So now we're in May, around the 14th. Remember last year we had frost, but I didn't get my dahlia started until May 18th. You know, we got them going. And what I do is I have to stake before I even plant. So I dig a hole, I put a stake in the ground, and then I plant my dahlia plant. I have to do that because I'll never go back and stake it later. So I make myself stake it before I even plant the dahlia. And you do want to stake them because, as you see, One of them got really tall. I'm thinking that's got to be around, I don't know, 14. It's a good 10 feet tall. That's, Skippity Grande. So.
What are you using for stakes?
Bamboo. I had an opportunity to get a whole bunch. I harvested at this guy's house, and now I have them to stake up my plants. And they do hold up pretty good from year to year. So.
How thick? I can't remember. How thick are your stakes?
They're thicker. They're at least an inch around. I mean, I have some of the skinny ones. I started out at Home Depot. You buy like 10 or $3.99. I actually gave most of my steaks away.
So usually you can buy them at the Webster Arboretum, but you got to get there early because they go fast.
Yeah, Angie gets them all.
The Angie.
No, I have 1,500 of my own. So, and then what I do is between June and August, I fertilize, and you can pass around the fertilizer. I have three samples for each one. They're 10, 10, 10, and the label says where you can get it and how much, and if anybody wants that information or wants a sample. I didn't bring tons of them, but I did bring some. Garden Factory has it. 10, 10, 10. And it says, you could look at some of the labels. Yeah, and those prices, I just got them this past week. So that's the prices right now, what they have. So I fertilize, and also, a few years ago, my dahlias used to go like this, and it's because of the calcium. So I do use calcium in it. I use oyster shells, and they don't break down as quickly as other things, but they work for me. I put a little hand oyster shell in the hole before I plant it, and the calcium makes the stem stay nice and firm, because you'll know. If your garden, they're starting to droop, you'll know it's because of the calcium. And I know that because it happened to my gardens from years back. So, like a feed place where you would get cattle feed or cracked corn, stuff like that, you can get it. But there's other stuff too. I just can't remember the name of it right now, but it's like the stuff you use to melt ice. It's got calcium in there.
All right.
And you use a little bit of that. But I don't remember the name, but I can find out the name if anybody wants to call me, and if I don't have it, I will get back to you. But I have a big problem.
It's in a black spot. Okay. Turn it on for about $20.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. If you step it up, any of these guys that are ready, they lose their... Because over time, you're sucking out so much minerals out of that same spot year after year, so you have to replenish it.
Right. Yeah. But I mean, we're all friends here. Your neighbor next to you, 40-pound bag is way too much. Talk to your neighbor next to you and say, hey, can we go in halves and maybe get the 10-10-10 or a bag of sawdust? You know, ask each other, and maybe if one of you can purchase it and split it, then you don't have as much. Because like when I had my 10-10-10, I put it in bottles because it's so much easier to maneuver it around in my garden than a bag that starts ripping and stuff. So I save all my containers. But you got to really make sure you label it, because you think you're going to remember one. So, yeah, and I try to fertilize 3 times. For some reason, I never have enough time, and it ends up being twice, but I'm trying to get better. But a couple weeks after I plant is when I start. You want to make sure your roots are really established before you start fertilizing. I mean, like if you do it the first week of July, You'll be fine.
Sounds like an
And then maybe every 2 weeks, you say, two, 3 weeks. Yeah. I mean, it's when I can get around to doing it. And then what I do, too, is here's another thing that I got turned on to, and it's pretty neat. And so you attach it to your hose. I don't know if anybody is, has anybody here today never seen this? Raise your hand. What it does.
I have one.
You haven't?
No, I have one.
Okay. Well, this one has, and I got these at Garden Factory. And when you put the fertilizer in here, you don't have to worry about diluting it because the water goes through and it picks up a little bit of the fertilizer. So you can't miracle grow or any of those. And then you put it in here with water and it'll, you know, it'll water your plants. And the word is systemically, that you're fertilizing the leaves and not the ground. So I do this once a year too. And it helps. You can tell after you fertilize.
Could you just explain it to me a little bit better?
So I'm going to give it to you. I have a lot of those. So you got to give it to her.
Okay,
we'll talk after.
Okay, make sure. Because it doesn't do any good to let it sit on the garage shelf. So,
so I try to fertilize 3 times.
This is the front of my house. There's about 270
yards.
The rest are all in the back.
Of course, part of the front. Close. Needs all the space. A shovel, a few inches, another shovel.
Because I tell you,
you know what?
Do that because two things I know about a property. One is sandy loam.
Okay.
It's not clay. If you did this at my house, it would die. You know it's going to fall. She's good son.
And I'll show you other things that people with clay can't do later on, too. This is my favorite of all dahlias. Didn't anybody want to know that?
Also, how deep do you plant them?
I plant them between 4 to 5 inches down.
And how far do you stick your stake down?
I have this piece of metal, and I jab it in the ground, and I didn't bring it today. But my dad actually made it. And I jab it down, and I wiggle it, and I try to get it down further, and then I just replace it with the stake. So I'm thinking a good one. By the time, it's because what I do is I dig my hole first, I stake. So you're already down the ground about 4 to 6 inches.
Mm-hmm.
And then you put the stake. So it's in there 12 inches.
I got stake. Well, I know the stakes last year, so that must have been because didn't stake for
a Yeah. And the tool I got, if you ever want to see it, it's a really good tool of some kind of things. If you can't buy anything like that, I'm sure you could make something, or even a hammer and a piece of metal going in the ground would work, because you want to make it go down and up.
Somebody want to see me after, I'll show them how to do it.
Okay. Yeah, so,
Angie, my husband got a drill bit. You put it on the drill and I used that.
That's easy. And speaking of what she just said, I think next year, instead of me doing a talk, I think we should bring all our tools, like you bring that, of what makes our life easier with working with the others. And I think that would be a good show to do, you know, a good talk. Everybody bring their tools. And we can learn from each other, because that's what it's about, helping each other more.
How do you pronounce it?
And this is what it looks like when I'm harvesting. A Okay, that's my address. The letters are like almost a foot each. This is my last slide, and it's I invite each and every one of you, so you got my card, call me, come over, spring, fall, I'll put you to work, or I'll teach you, or I'll help you, or if you need tubers, I got tubers too. So that's my address.
But what street is that?
Yep.
What street?
Cross Kills the Dahlias. And I wait, I start, once the dahlias die, I start digging, but that's because I have so many. But the longer you wait, the plumper they get in the ground. So if you wait 1 to 2 weeks before you start digging them, that's really good for them. And Diane, you guys, that do, don't you think they sort of like a little eye up too? Because they go
yeah, they down. Do. And they harden up.
Yeah, and they harden up. So,
but I've done it before. If I'm going away, I've come before frost, and they're still okay, but they're not as good.
Me too. I have seen no difference before frost and after frost.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm.
And I just got to keep digging when I get to that point. I've got to tell you, this year, though, I got to the point, which might be a good thing for you guys. I got to the point I hated dahlias.
No! My ears hurt!
Listen to this. The other part is I didn't order any this year. So it might be a good thing when you start hating dahlias at the end, when you're digging them up. But what I do is I wait after frost and I start digging them up. I cut the stalks, and everybody's got their way of doing it. When the frost kills the stalk, it's really flimsy. It's hard to manage it. If you cut them before the frost kills them, they're stiff and sturdy, and you can just throw them out. It's just easier to handle them, but nobody wants to kill their dahlias before frost. So, but once I...
And it's just one second for an improvement. The question was, did you dig them up before you cut the stakes, cut the stalks off? And it's only the way you have it in order. You said dig them up and then cut the stake, cut stalks.
You know what?
Yeah.
It depends on my moods.
Okay.
Because
yeah.
What I do is I'll pull like 5 bamboo stakes out, and then I'll dig them up. And as I'm digging them, I have 2 wheelbarrows. One that I put the stock in, and then the other one that I'm washing them with. So I do it that way, but if you cut them down and leave them like a foot, then you don't have to bend down as far. So never cut them real close to the ground, because who wants to bend that far down? Yes, please.
I have something to add to your discussion. Sorry. When your tuber is in the ground and growing, it has one stem, supposedly. If you chop that off in July, your tuber is going to start growing again, and it will come up through the ground. When you have frost, you kill the stem, and your tuber is still warm in the ground, and it will still produce an eye, and it will start growing again out of the ground. So when we tell you to wait 1 or 2 weeks, really what you're doing is you're establishing a new eye so you can see it when you're cutting your tubers apart in over the winter, whenever you're doing it, in the fall or in the spring. You can see that tuber has already started. If you cut your plant and cut it off and take it out of the ground immediately, you won't see the eyes. It's not saying the eyes aren't there, but you're not going to be able to see them. So that's why you wait a week or two after frost. Because if you wait any longer than that, your eyes are going to be growing, they're going to be inch high, they're going to be 2 inches high. They're going to try, the plant will still continue to grow until the frost actually kills the tuber. So if you leave it in, you have frost in November, and they're still in December, you probably still haven't killed the tuber yet. They're still in the ground, they're still trying to grow. They might be growing slower because it's colder, but that's what's happening in the fall when you're growing your tubers and pulling them off.
That happened to me this year. One of my dahlias, it broke completely to the ground, and I had like 8 or 10, you know, plants coming out of that one clump because it happened like, I don't know, August, September.
As an old experiment is for all of you, try that in August. Just cut one of your stalks off, and we all have extras or ones we don't like. Cut one off in August. Make sure you cover that hole, though. Mm-hmm. But let it grow. It'll start back up again.
And there's stuff you can do to your stakes, your stalks. Some people put aluminum foil over it so it doesn't get water, because water would start rotting out the tuber if it gets too much in there. They have that foam that you can spray into the stalk, and some of the stalks had a ton of water in them this year. I mean, you talk about having a dry summer, why were the stalks so full? But I had a lot of them like that. Yeah. But yeah, Peter, it's exactly right what you said. So,
here's my wagon, and I use it to carry my bamboo stakes. I try to get them organized. And the blue bucket has my bleach, 10% bleach, 90% water, and then the red bucket has just water in it and clay. I don't have clay. I have good soil. So what I do is I just wash them. I put them in a
laundry basket.
I put them in a laundry basket. I put these in the buckets, and I just leave them there. And then when I have enough, I just go up and down, and it washes them. And then I take it from the water, and I put it in the bleach water. And I don't leave it there very long. I'll dig up like 5 or 6 more tubers, then I take it out, put it on its side, and let them dry.
Tell
them
where you
get
it.
Oh, I got
a question.
Okay.
I know everybody does the Clorox, I do the Clorox. What are we actually killing? We're not killing viruses.
No.
No.
So what are we killing?
Bugs.
What is attacking our tubers if we don't?
Anybody figure that out? Come back and let us know next month.
August. But Ange, here's the other thing, that once you start cutting off all the feeder roots and that's it's dangerous. That's what you need to.
What did you say, Debbie?
My opinion is, when you just dig them up, I don't know why you bleach them. I mean, I don't do that, because to me the dangerous time is when you start trimming the feeder roots and you have exposed areas.
I do mine here.
Well, I cut all my feeder tubers and stuff, but that's another discussion. We'll talk about that in a second. But I like these because they have a lot of holes in it, and they dry really good. So these I got at Tops, and they were a buck. And wait till you find these kind. Don't get the smaller ones, because tubers are pretty big. So they don't have them right now at my Tops, but they do get them periodically. So, and these are cool to have.
Like a dollar aisle.
They
can dry. Dollar aisle at Tops, right?
Yeah. Tops, Dollar Tree. I found some at the Dollar Tree too. But. But see, this is what my tubers look like, so I don't have to spray them. I was spraying them before I got this method, and I'd walk into my house and I'd be sopping wet and cold. So this is, once I dig them up, I don't touch the tubers until I'm putting them away, which you're not handling them as much, broken necks, whatever. But let me go back to that. Okay. Vinny says to me, and it makes sense to me, I don't know if it'll make sense to you, I haven't done it, but he's done it, not to kill all the feeder roots. I clean mine and I make them look squeaky clean, and he just dug them up and left everything. And he said it gives them a start in the spring because it's already got some roots established. So I haven't done that yet, but that's food for thought. I don't know what you guys think of that.
When does Vinny cut his up?
Well,
What the Andrew Paul still? I think it's a couple of weeks. You come in the fall, then you're probably taking them up and kind of exposing all that anyway. Just once on.
Yeah, and I mean,
he's put them in clumps, put them away for the winter.
Right. I put mine, and that's the other thing. Do what you are used to doing, not what someone tells you. Some people cut them up in the fall before they put them away. Some people use vermiculite, some people use sawdust, peat moss, whatever works for you. And how you've done them in years, keep doing them that way. You know, unless something really drastic has happened to your tennis, then maybe you need to change how you're doing. But mine come out like that. So I carry them right into the house, and I bring them in the house, I put them on the shelves, and I start drying them. And here's one of my drying racks.
How long do you leave them there to dry?
I try about 4 days. I can tell, you can really tell when the tubers are still wet. And sometimes you need to take the tuber from one, if you have them in one area, and because they're wet on the bottom, then you need to go like this and put them in the other one and let the bottoms dry, because sometimes the laundry baskets don't dry them right. And I notice if you have a lot of little ones, they don't dry like the bigger ones, get more air around them. So maybe 2-3 days would work for you if you have big clumps of tubers. Mine, I start off with like 4 days. But, you know, it depends on what I'm doing. I might put away 4 laundry baskets in one day. I might put away 2 because they're still wet. So I just look at them, and you can tell whether they're wet or dry enough to bring them in and put them away. But the sawdust I use, I do lose some. And when I bring them up in the spring, there are some mold on some of them, and I've lost tubers and stuff, but I've gone to the fact that you're going to keep some tubers and you're going to always lose some tubers, you know, and that's it.
Do
and then I put them in.
Do you find that some varieties seem to be not as well as others?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Honest to God, I will never buy Spider Woman again because it's $10 a tuber and I keep buying it and it dies. I won't buy that anymore. I'm not going to throw my money away on the Spider Woman.
Why does it die?
It doesn't tuber well. Not at all. And then you get Blizzard, it tubers really well. Rip City tubers really well. You know, you'll know the ones that tuber.
Sunny.
Hanka.
Yeah, yeah. Sunny.
You can't sell one now.
Cornhair's good, too.
Yeah. I had a few people tell me they leave their dahlias and they come up year after year. It's like, okay. Yeah. But I have, when I put my tubers away in the winter, I put them in these. And I put glue. And the only reason I do this is so when I'm carrying them downstairs, all the sawdust doesn't go down like Hansel and Gretel's.
When you say sawdust, you mean wood shaving?
Chips.
Wood shaving.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not. Don't ever do sawdust. I had a clumping. It looked like a big film on my tubers 1 year. I do have a few samples, and
they went around.
And you can pass those around. And where I get it.
Is it
wood chips or is it chips? I don't know, what do you call this? I brought a bag, and somebody can actually take this bag. But this is what I use. And I'll call Country Max. I'll call Country Max and I'll go, I want the red and white one. And they'll tell me, we don't have it, we have the green. So don't take no for an answer. What I had to do for my wood shavings, chips, whatever you want to call them, I had to go to Henrietta at Country Max and get it. They had.
What's the difference between the red and the green?
The green one's real, real fine. You don't want that.
Oh.
You want this because it'll come off your tuber. The other one just cakes on. It's like putting frosting on a cake. It just sticks right to it. So.
hamsters or something?
The trays that you store them in, are they the same trays that you can't
use? No.
Yeah.
Because these, I take the time to glue something on them. And if you do that, and if you pot them up in these, that will come out.
That's true.
So I use separate ones. One's called boxing it, and then I tray them up in the spring.
Okay, but it's the same material, you just treat it differently.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're closing the clumps up in that box.
And I closed it up.
How deep is the...
I cut a few clumps up, but I also have real old styrofoam boxes that are about an inch more, and that inch makes a difference. But there's four boxes here, and after, you guys are welcome to take them.
And the lid is thinner than the because it's the way it's... Put the grapes on the bottom.
Wood shaving is one of the results. But if anybody wants a bag to take with them to country match, you're welcome to it.
You could use just about anything you want.
Then I take it into the basement.
I wait till fall, but I mean it's spring.
My basement's actually bigger than my house by my porch in the front. And that's where I store all my dahlias. Inside there, and the temperature stays between 40 and 50. And it doesn't go under it. That's what it stays all winter. So I have the ideal place to store my dahlias. Can I just show you a few pictures?
That's pretty.
Gay princess, you want that in your garden. Do you know why you want it in your garden?
Why?
It has between 20 and 30 blooms on it at any given time.
Wow.
It just blooms this little old heart out, I say. And just peachy, yeah, you want this in your garden. And tuber as well. If you're going to have a tubering dahlia, you want just peachy. And Harvey Coop, everybody wants this in a flower arrangement in the fall. But that, I get it, it dies. I buy it again. Mm-hmm. Andy Corbett, one of my favorites too. And there's Sunny. Yeah. And Sunny though, I love it and I'll grow it. But mine used to stay short, but this past couple of years it's been growing taller. So I don't know. And I lost my Verones. My Verones obsidian, I had tons of it last year. I planted it. I don't know what happened. I've actually lost that one. Is that like another crazy one? What do they call it? Anglian? How do you pronounce it?
Anemone.
And this is what it looks like when I'm harvesting. Okay, that's my address. The letters are like almost a foot each. This is my last slide, and it's I invite each and every one of you, so you got my card, call me, come over, spring, fall, I'll put you to work.